After a great game two, he was able to force a third game out of his opponent. The Terran starting to the bottom right.
SK Telecom T1 Fantasy.
If he can win this map, his dream of going to the Premier League is not going to be a fantasy any longer.
No.
Starting to the bottom left is his opponent.
Azubu Sleep.
Sleep with a really good macro game in game number one, but in game number two he had a big problem with his injects. He was in control of a macro hedge for the most part of the game. He had the lava at the beginning, but then he was starting to miss injects, and that put him in a position where he was floating 2,000 minerals, 1,000 gas at times, could not put that into units at a crucial point in the game where he needed to crush the attacks of Fantasy. But the SKT1 player with a very, very strong game, always barreling down on Sleep's fourth base and sending additional troops into the main and to the third base. Great game so far, and let's see what game number three holds. Once again, the early scout by Sleep with the drone.
He's not taking any chances. Not on two-player maps, not on four-player maps. He's taking this series so seriously. And honestly, Sleep has been a player who's been around since really the very beginning of competitive Korean StarCraft 2. He was on LGIM. Before LGIM was LGIM, he was on IM. And that's where he got his ID, or that's kind of where his ID played through, because he was IM Sleep, which kind of sounds funny. It sounds like a play on I'm sleeping. But as it is, I mean, this guy has really shown waves here at the end. Both players microing hardcore here. Drone gets away with one health. But I feel like this is the most dominant we've ever really seen Sleep in StarCraft 2. And he's actually becoming one of the big powerhouses for Azubu, just like Symbol.
What I find interesting in this game now in particular, while I agree with everything that you just said, especially with Sleep's current shape that he's in, Fantasy playing the command center on the high ground this time, not on the low ground, signaling a little bit that he wants to play this a bit safer than what he did on the last map. But he still is trying to stick to his guns. He was quite successful with the strategy in game number two. And after the first game, I already mentioned that I feel a lot is about Fantasy trying to figure out Sleep style. He didn't expect the Mutalisk commitment in the first game, and it kind of threw him off guard a little bit. So from that point on, Sleep gained control of the map and played ping pong with his opponent. And Fantasy wants to make sure that this doesn't happen again. So game number two was very different from how the game went down. And I feel that Sleep also realized that. Sleep in the second game, after he like lost the match, he was probably just sitting down and was like, okay, I had a problem with my macro, I was lacking lava, I had too many resources that I could not use. If I get a hold of that, I can force him into a position like in game number one again. And if I achieve that, if I put him into the same spot again, then he cannot win a game against me because I dictate his every move. So I feel the mid game, and the early mid game in particular, is where this game is going to be decided.
Yeah, and that was what happened in game one, I mean, and in game two really, was how much damage could Fantasy get done. Game number one, it turns out, not a whole lot. And game number two, it was just really good trades. And then again, eventually, because of all the multitasking that he forced from Sleep, he just struggled to macro properly to hit those injects.
It's also one of those games where both players are just sticking with what they did before.
Yeah.
The builds that we see are the same builds that we saw in both games. And sometimes it's really refreshing to see players just changing up depending on the map and going for a different strategy. Just using, let's say, for example, a cheese suddenly, a proxy play, or something like that. But I really think that in this scenario, it's really cool to see both of them just going for it, because it worked for both of them, like, one game each, and they're
exactly.
Just like, dude, I am the better player in this. They're just like clinking hats right now, and they're like, I'm gonna beat you at this game.
No, actually, that's exactly my favorite thing to see in a best of three, is when both players go for basically the same build all three games, with slight tweaks. Well, basically what they're saying is, I know how you play, and you know how I play, and we're both actually not going to change anything because we think both players think I'm better than him at this. I can do this. I messed up in game two. The fans think I messed up in game one, but they're sticking to their guns here, and I really like that. I'm actually in the same opinion as you on this.
I'm loving it. I mean, this is going to be so great. I'm really excited for this game. This is going to be epic.
Same fast third CC from Fantasy as well here.
Fast speed for the Overlords. Once again, Sleep is probably just going to line them up and make sure that it drops from any direction. Cannot go unnoticed. And we have him with the attempt to spread the creep. The four queens that we saw in game one and two are there once again. He's even getting another one. He's going for five queens now. We have him with a double evolution chamber, the spine caller for safety, Overlord in the main base, spotting the third CC. They are both realizing that they are up against the same strategy.
It's a lot harder to spread creep on this map. As you can see, Sleep not able to spread it too far, because he has to go down a ramp, and there's two choke points with those rocks there, so every time he sends his queens one direction, the Hellions swing around the next, because they're just much faster. Even then, of course, when the queens are on creep, queens are one of the slowest units in StarCraft 2. But it doesn't matter too much, considering that he's still able to connect his bases. And on this map, as a Zerg player, the fourth base is relatively accessible. As you can see, Sleep has spread his creep in two different directions, one slightly up and one slightly down, and he will take that fourth base to the downside. And speaking of downsides, the downside to this fourth base, of course, is that it's closer to Fantasy, so when Fantasy is attacking, he can attack both sides.
Then the Hellions are still trying to force a few creep tumors down, but holding this Zanaga Watchtower for now is important. The Overlords are already splitting, they're everywhere on the map, and Sleep is starting to add the additional guys. As he's going into the lair tech, he's adding the Baneling Nest, of course he needs that, droning up. He wants to get those Mutalists out again. Once he has a good Mutalist count on them, a big map like Frost, he should be able to put the pressure on Fantasy. And I would actually love to see him get the Mutalist numbers, because I would like to see how Fantasy reacts this time after what happened in game number one.
He added some Thors in game number two, but like, the Mutalist count was never at the same level that it was in game number one.
It depends a lot if he's like the player who starts to become like who initiates the attacks, who wants to be on the map and aggressive, or if he's the one to defend. I feel like both scenarios demand for different like responses. In one, you could do with a lot of like Widow Mines, very stationary in the mineral lines. You could go for additional missile turrets, maybe even the building armor. And with the other one, you have to have the Widow Mines out on the field. You have to have the extra Thors in there, and then make sure that they are of course guarded by Marines, so that there is no potential for a Magic Fox taking them out. But for now, we have the Tarimplayer moving in with a really good scan, taking down a lot of the creep tumors. And this is one of the moves, this is one of the key moves that we see in every Terran player's gameplay. Going in when you have the first medivacs, killing everything in sight, and if the army moves in, picking it up, and after burning it.
He wants to actually force a cancel on this fourth base, and since he keeps the Hellions here, because last time he lost those, this time he has them, I think he actually gets it, and in fact he does! Loses his Hellions, but it's worth it to force that cancel.
Yeah, I mean, there were definitely some costs involved for the Terran player, but it was definitely worth it for him. That hatch canceled in the last second was, by the way, impressive how close Sleep was to letting that finish, you know, and not using the cancel, but then in the last millisecond, he just bam.
This choke point right here, I wouldn't even be surprised if we saw two depots dropped there to lock that down at some point in the game, just because this is going to be one of the most highly contested points for Sleep, because he wants to have the concave on the other side, but it's hard for him to go back into that area, and Fancy could just put depots on it.
I expect him to burrow some Banelings there.
He needs to do something like that, or I would like to see maybe even some spines on the other side.
It's a very obvious position to like burrow the Banelings, but if you bait out a scan, it's kind of worth it already.
He's making spine crawlers. He needs to have spines on the other side of that. Choke points are always dominated by the player who has the concave on the other side. But as a Zerg player, you don't have ranged units at this point in time, so it's actually hard to engage. As you can see here, every time he just steps back in the choke point.
Nice.
And his Sleep is not going to go in that choke point.
He takes down the creep tumor. Really important, because like the creep tumor is what really makes this play for Sleep. It gives him the speed that he needs at this position. But now taking out that one creep tumor, he targeted that. That was like purposefully. It's not like that he just randomly like killed that. He wanted to target it down, and he did. He kills both, and now he forces the creep back. And with that, he has a better edge, but he overextended a little bit, and the commitment of the Banelings takes down a fair number of Marines.
Yeah, one more Baneling hit would have actually killed maybe 7 or 8 of those.
Mutalisks now coming into play.
Yeah, 12 of them, so he's going pretty heavy here. And this is the choke point I'm talking about. He can never engage against this choke point that Fantasy is controlling right now. He wants to take control of it. Maybe even just going around would be the better option for him. I'd like to see a faster transition to maybe Infestors too. Here come the spines I was talking about. If he get the spines up, then he can finally try to control that choke point. And Fantasy knows it.
I don't really think that he minds too much fighting here. I don't think he minds that at all. The Terran player is the one who has to go around, because sitting on four bases, Sleep is going to be really happy with this. The attack to the left side is a bit of a different issue.
Yeah, that's definitely going to be a little bit of an annoyance for him. Fantasy not using it very quickly, so a small group of Lings will easily clean this up. It's that creep spread. He has creep even spread way to the north just because of little things like this. Yeah. He always has that vision. See how much the spine claws help him actually stop Fantasy from edging forward.
But I think at this point, time is really of the essence. Look at all the... Where are the overlords, the additional ones for Sleep? Where is him putting this money to use? He needs to get rid of those resources. He needs units in the game. But first of all, he needs to get overlords, and he's missing them. Yep. He doesn't have any. He has, once again, his lava problem.
Yeah, he's having his lava problem. He's only got two larva as we speak.
No macro hatch this time.
So difficult to engage this. You know, he just comes in here, engages, trades against the Zerglings, and which is becoming more and more of a problem with this larva mechanic that Sleep is kind of messing up. But actually now, he baits out the Widowmine shots and goes through.
Really good hits there, but he I cannot repeat myself often enough. He has a problem with the lava, and if he goes for this many Zerglings over and over again, trying to go into Banelings, this is a very lava mechanics, lava-heavy style that he does. He needs a macro hatch. There it is. There he puts down the macro hatch. Too late a little bit. In the second game and in the first, he got that much, much faster. Mutalisk is more and more coming into the game now. He wants to have the high ground here to defend this base, and so far he has done a decent job at that. But he needs to start taking the initiative, and that's only possible for him if he gets rid of the resources and puts that into units.
Yeah. This has actually just been so fun to watch how these two players go for their same styles. Yeah. The aggression here from Fancy. You will get the queen. Yes, the queen does go down. But he engages, you know, a little bit too far on creep, loses a lot of his units. But just because of the inject problem that Sleep has, he has a ton more resources all the time, but he's not using his bank.
Well, he has it now. He has the lava now. Now he's, okay, he depleted it just as we spoke. But he should probably also have a couple of additional mutalists now coming. He has 21s already, 15 Banelings. Here comes the job, and now he has the high ground. The Tarion player really forcing his way into this position, and the mutalists have to go down to take down these units. They have to come in the main base, and that's what they are doing, immediately shutting down the drop play. But Fantasy moves in as he sees the mutalists in the main base. He moves in with the rest of the army, is trying to make sure that he is putting more and more pressure onto that fourth base of his opponent.
You know, have you noticed that it seems like when Fancy engages with drops, he always targets the queens? I think he knows that Sleep actually is going so larva intensive with the style he's playing that he's just trying to abuse that. He's saying, okay, well, you're training your lings against my army every time at the choke point, and I'm just going to kill your larva. And Sleep goes for a massive counterattack here. Will lose the hatchery. But can Fancy defend? This time he raised the depot, but there's a ton of Banelings rolling through here.
This is such a massive counter aggression that we currently have. To the top left, Sleep is expanding once again. The Tarion player trying to move a few of his units back. There are a couple of burrowed Banelings not being used. The Mutalisks in the main base now. That Thor is never going to catch up with them. He's way too slow.
And the add-ons here are under attack. Those Banelings could unburrow to maybe try to catch some of these Marines. There's a
Fantasy.
Huge scan there.
He turned back. He took down the fourth, and now he's turning back. And there are other Banelings, and they're being used, but they're only taking down a few units. Even in the main base now, we have burrowed Banelings. But Thor is closing the distance. The army supply is in favor of the Terror Blade with 125 against 113. But the Mutalisks, they escape. The Widow Mines, they burrow.
Oh, the Banelings! Oh, beautiful hits here! Wow, you know what? Sleep is really turning this around. He's taking the momentum away from Fantasy. He's killed so many Harvesters here. He's retaken that base to the north, like you mentioned, making more Mutas here.
He just
3-3.
Killed another command center. He just killed another one. That was the one that Fantasy was trying to establish. To the top left, that base has been spotted. They are going blow for blow here. Sleep is really trying to get back into the picture.
He should be able to snipe the hatchery if he targets it, but he's not. He's too worried about the Marines over here. The Mutalisks, on the other hand.
34.
And he takes out the last of these Marines, knows the bunkers over here. It's kind of what I'm talking about. He could have made depots. He starts to make bunkers as well. He's trying to set up a really tight position on that base. But now he knows, okay, this is not the base I need to be worried about anymore. I need to be worried about the base that's far away up to the 9 o'clock position.
He cannot move to the top. I don't think he can. He's trying to intercept those Mutalisks. But if they see that, they should be able to move back in time. If he just tries to circumvent that army, he could do a lot. Oh, those medivacs need to be careful.
They're so low on hit points, so many of those.
If he can sneak a few drones to the top left or top right, he could just expand there, and he's just going for it with the Mutalisk. So much kill power here, but the same is true for Fantasy.
Only 8 Banelings right now. Only 8 Banelings. He needs more. He's got 14 on the way, but this Bioforce in the middle of the map, he cannot ignore it. He's trying to force Fantasy to turn around, but Fantasy is not turning around.
Fantasy is going for it. That base is going to be sniped. He can fight the Marines easily.
Oh, he just goes for the kill, and now he wants to come in to try to fight with these Mutas. He's losing a lot of drones in the process, down to 55 here. Supply block for Fantasy.
He has the army supply, you know. He could actually move in from every angle and then use the Mutalisks with Magic Box to take down the Thors. I think he definitely has the option to do that. Mutalisks are already streaming in. Second armor upgrade is not ready, though.
And here we go, the flanks from every angle. So many Thors. On the other hand, Magic Box number one is good. More units coming from the left side. dodges on most of the Widowmines. Will he engage? Yes, the answer is yes. He rolls through so many Butyliths.
He's down in supply right now, but he's going for it with another Magic Box. He takes down Thor number two on the ground. We don't have a lot of units left anymore, but at the same time, the Butylith stuff is insane. It's 28 still, and he takes down the Thor. He goes for the Marines. The reinforcements for Fantasy streaming in. This is crazy. 64 against 70 army supply. Both players just at each other's throat.
He needs more Banelings. He's making 7 of them right now. Remember, Sleep has a massive amount of Mutilus, but he does not have any answer, of course, for the 3-3. Not yet. He is trying to get his own bases retaken. He lost the base of the south. He's remade that one. He has the gases there. He needs to remake his fifth base, the one that was in the center. He's continuing to control the map with his Mutilus, on the other hand.
The plus two armor upgrade is going to help him with the Mutilus a lot, but he needs to hit the economy of his opponent. We have Fantasy down in Harvesters, but he has the Mules. And here come the Mutilus. If you have this many Mutilus, he can one-shot turrets without a problem at all. The Marine splits, on the other hand, for Fantasy is real. They're really good. He has Marines everywhere, at every single base. The income for Sleep at this point is better. He has four bases. He's mining from three, running low on minerals at the natural. In the main base, we have only one patch left, plus two armor just hit for the Mutilus. That's going to help him a lot.
Yeah, it really will. And the worker count for Fantasy, dangerously low here. 17 Banelings on the way. Good Widow Mines here. He's actually just starting to scatter the Widow Mines around his bases, because even if he can focus those down with Overseers, he has to micro a little bit more. That buys him time to get his Marines back home. And the economy is actually in tatters for Sleep right now. He has the better army, where he has the better control of the map with his Kreishard, with his Mutilus, but he needs to make sure that he can defend these bases, because his economy is really, really hurting right now.
Sleep suffered a lot in the game. You know, in all the other matches that we had, he was going into Hive, he was trying to get his 3-3, but now he's not in a position to do that. He has to finish it with what he has. I don't think we're going to see like this tech anytime soon. He's just trying to use the mobility of his Mutilus, and he's moving in with the Banelings. A nice lift here. What a pair! That Widowmine shot! How many Banelings did he kill there? That was insane!
That was actually a massive blow to Sleep's army size. He didn't actually kill that command center, but the Mutas are doing so much damage. They're really starting to whittle away at everything here, and they're hurting the production. He's starting to kill barracks, he's killing more add-ons, he's killing the reactors, and now Sleep actually has the chance to remake a hatchery in the center of the map if he wants to.
The Marines are running. They are all trying to pull a Forest Gump here, but without those Widow Mines, I feel that Fantasy would already be down. As is, though, he's ahead in overall supply, and I think with Sleep not having any satellite bases to, like, far away positions in the game, I don't really think that in the long run he's going to be able to sustain this.
Well, he has the better income right now.
Yeah, he does. I mean, it's true. Fantasy is relying too much on this one base, this one exactly, the third. Everywhere else, he doesn't have the mineral patches anymore.
Yeah, he should actually move his natural or his main command center, I feel, to a better location. The thing is, moving it away from that means that the Mutilists are actually going to find it and kill it, because if there's a command center on the map, Sleep is looking for it. And these...
Oh, no, I actually like that. Without the Widow Mines, Fantasy is not going to do anything in this game.
That scan was so close. And actually, if he comes in, after he kills the...
He sees the Widow Mines.
He needs to be careful here, and he's just going to fly away. Meanwhile, he goes in to the south. He goes in. If he can eliminate these units, then he'll win the game. That's basically the last thing he needs to do here. He's resecured that mining at the south. I thought he had a drone building a base to the north. I guess he's sitting up there. Maybe it got sniped.
That gas band that we currently have for Sleep, that's so dangerous for Fantasy. A tech switch at any point in time could occur here for the Zerg player. Well, not really a tech switch, but the switch back into a massive amount of Mutilus. That's what I want to say. So far, he's relying a lot on the Zerglings, because he needs the Banelings and Zerglings against the Marine numbers that we have. 85. That's a danger no matter how many Mutilus you have.
Yeah. And
you don't want to go into that choke point.
No. No, you do not. 8 more Banelings on the way here. He's just truly trying to manage his mineral resources. He's a little bit low on that. And those were actually the best hits that Fantasy could have hoped for here.
Oh, both of them, really, with such an intense game. 59 Marines against those Mutilus. 22 of them are left.
He's going for the chase.
Just for a second. He's trying to go for that. He has that one Overseer with his army, and that is really crucial. He needs to find those borrowed Widow Mines. We do not have additional Mutilus being built so far. He's relying on a lot of Zerglings. Borrowing in the Banelings now on the bridge.
I guess this is actually a little bit of a safer place for him to burrow them, because the bridge is, like you said before several times, the most predictable place for him to burrow.
Both of them are really bloody in this game. They are bloody, they are injured, they are fighting with their last breath. Both of them trying to stabilize here. Fantasy is attempting to force the issue, whereas Sleep is expanding again. Fantasy, just with this one base that he has, he's not relocating one of his command centers. And over and over again, Sleep is just showing his Mutalisks at this third. He's like, leave it alone for a second, and I'm going to be there. And I'm
exactly. And during all of this, now he's finally able to remake his center base. Now, if he can actually do this a little bit longer, this dance of death with the Mutalisks, and get another base to the north, and have basically a three-base economy again, he will be able to transition into another tech or get investors out, or just go, like you said, back into heavy Mutalisks. And that is not engaging. He wants to take off creep against this many Marines. He may not actually hold this base. He needs to bring his Mutas back. There they are.
We are 28 minutes into the game, and we have no Hive Tech. And we might not ever see a Hive Tech in this game, just not because of the resource. It's more an issue of time in this point.
Here we go. Banley's rolling in. It.
They are rolling.
Fantasy sees it.
And oh, the Soul Close. They're chasing, and they detonate and kill a lot of the SCVs. 17 are left. Workers killed by Sleep. 54 so far.
Fantasy can be very happy that he was able to see that coming. Had he not, this could have changed the game drastically.
But Mules are pretty strong here. Once more, the Mutalisks on the move. One Widowmine shot going off, but the Mutalisks will heal in time.
Yeah, the thing is, it's actually better for him to take shots on his Mutas as long as they don't die than to take it on his Banelings, because the Mutas will regen, like you said.
Fantasy needs another base, and he's taking it. Finally, he goes for it, and he established this one base, which is kind of safe since he's going pressure in this direction anyways. And the spread of the Overlords in the beginning, the one thing that we point out in game number two already, it's coming to play again. He snipes the drop. The Mutalisks are just his answer to everything. No higher tech just yet, but Mutalisks, that is what he's utilizing here, the mobility.
Both of these players are so aggressive, it's hard for one of them to, for example, just to put
here
the
mules
into a new
here
base.
We go.
Here we go, he actually kills the sensor tower and the bunker. Like you said, if you leave him a second alone for 1 second, he only has two command centers. If he kills this command center, that means there's only one left, and he cannot afford to make any more right now.
The command center, still alive, but that was a close call here. Three CCs in the game. That hatch goes down. There were not a lot of mineral patches left, but that income loss is going to hurt him regardless.
Yeah, you're right. There are three CCs. The one at the natural is still alive here. My mistake, but he's not using it. He's finally realizing, you know, I better lift it up and actually make
use of it.
Three
Marines.
Three Marines. He gets away.
But the Mutalisk numbers are slowly and steadily starting to decline here. Only 19 of them left. The army supply is currently in favor of Fantasy with 87, and with the Mules he still has the income. So Sleep is losing a bit of the momentum that he has. With him having less army supply on the map, he cannot force the engagements as he could before.
And, you know, he's running out of gas income. He doesn't need it as much as he needs minerals right now, but he's certainly not in the lead he once was before. Good baits on those Widowmines. He's going to run in. I don't think he realizes there's two more, but he does not care. Beautiful target there by Fantasy on the Widowmine, getting most of those Banelings.
Wow, the Marines there. There are so many of them left. 39 against 19 Mutalisks. The Mutalisks are there, but they cannot fight this. They need ground support. Where are those 10 Banelings? Burrowed all over the map, I guess. No, there they are.
There
moving
they are.
In, but still, they are focused down, and Fantasy
Nine
with
more.
The control is going for this. This is the last
he
base.
Has to
he
tank.
Has to fight!
He has to tank with his Mutas! And here come the Banelings! Some of them not finished for the rest of the two! Beautiful splits by Fantasy on the other hand!
GG! Game over! Fantasy goes to the Premier League! He takes Game 3! Sleep and Fantasy, what a third game! What a series!
What a series! And this is why StarCraft 2 is a beautiful game. This is why TBZ is a beautiful matchup. And these two players gave us a great show because they stuck to their guns, they stuck to their styles. And you know what, I think actually after watching this game, Frost has become my favorite map that we have ever had in StarCraft 2. That was, I think...
I cannot understand how he can just sit there and pack up his gear. I would just start screaming, jumping up and down, going for the Becker fist here or whatever, punching that monitor and be like, yes! But Fantasy goes to the Premier League and he looks like he does that every day at least twice.
Wow, I gotta say, the control we saw from both those players was out of control. I'm struggling to find words to describe how awesome that game was.
It was great. It was a really great game. Both of them just the entire time with non-stop action. For Sleep, just it's really this late macro hatch. It was so late in the game, and he lost so much momentum because of it. He showed in game one, in game two, that he wants to go to Hive. He wants to go for 3-3. He wants to be on par with his opponent in the upgrades. But facing a Terran player on simple lair tech that has 3-3 upgrades in the long run, most Zergs will lose that.
Yeah.
And without the macro hatch, he could once more not use his resources when he was so important, and then he was just struggling. It looked for a long time, on the other hand, like he was able to pull it off.
Yeah, I mean, he really took some of the best engagements that he could have in the south on that bridge, which is so hard to engage in the choke point there. And I liked his decision to make some spine crawlers there. He was really holding on to that. And once he got enough gas from that base, he'd get his mutilus count high. That's when he kind of just said, okay, I'm going to let this go, take the base to the north instead, and then I'll harass you with my mutilus.
We had a couple of insane Widowmine hits on the other hand. The Banelings that were rolling in at the third base, and suddenly the Widowmine takes down like at least 10 of them.
Really good targeting by Fantasy.
We're having the match results, of course, once again summed up for you with the 2-0. Savage was able to take out DRG, one of the fastest series that we've seen in a long time. The Dong without a chance here. Avenge going down against SAS in a very tense series. Very, very close here.
Yeah, and then, of course, next one that we had was really, really close. A little bit sad that it was a team kill. Keen takes it 2-1. And our final game, tell your friends to watch this VOD if they did not catch it.
Yep.
I know a lot of you guys will be re-watching the VOD. Check out Sleep's Overlord spread, Fantasy's control. At Fantasy takes it 2-1, and we'll go to the Premier League, where a lot of his fans have been hoping for a long time it would be. Tomorrow we actually have some matches in the afternoon as well as in the night. Our afternoon matches, here they are.
At 1 p.m. we are starting things off with another mirror match. This time it's going to be Hydra. He's going up against Kang Ho. Hydra with impressive performance in the last round, but against Kang Ho it's going to be interesting what he's going to do there, since he has to play a second ZVZ and Kang Ho was able to study those games. Hurricane versus Hero is going to be game number 2.
Yeah, and then of course our third and fourth matches are going to be epic. Hyva versus Innovation and Supernova versus Byung for the TVT. And do not forget that also at 6 p.m. we have GSTL.
Exactly, the GSTL is coming up as well tomorrow, so we have a double day here at GOM. Hope that you tune in for that. Hope that you enjoyed the games today. Definitely the game matches that we saw between Sleep and Fantasy, one of the third game, one of the best games that we had this season so far in the Challenger League. Hope that you enjoyed the show. We're going to see you tomorrow. Have a good day.